Connectix Virtual Game Station is an interesting beast. This is a fully functional PlayStation 1 emulator from 1999, when the console was still at the height of its popularity. Connectix VGS was produced not by a group of people in their spare time, offering it for free, but rather a company who were full on selling it at retail. It was initially only available for Macintosh computers too. A PC version joined it eventually, but essentially, it was built around the specs of the original iMac. The legal brouhaha that resulted from its release is cited as one of the key reasons console companies don't send cease and desist letters to emulator developers. Sony tried it with these guys, and lost. Anyway, my objective here today then is to get my hands dirty with it, try a bunch of games on it, and find out, is it any good? Welcome to YesterYear's Mac Games, where today, we're not looking at a Mac game, although we are looking at games. And they're on an old Mac. They can also be played on this old Mac. We're going to be looking at this emulator's compatibility and playability with the PS1 titles that I own. And hopefully, shine a bit of light onto whether an Apple Macintosh, loaded with the classic macOS, made a good enough PlayStation substitute. Were Sony right to freak out after their loss in court and buy the software outright in order to lock it away? Let's find out. Connectix VGS was built for a G3 Mac with a 233MHz processor. To run it well, the Mac or PC that you're using should be faster than that. It had no OS X port and it can't run in classic mode. This then is compatible with a rather peculiar set of machines. I'll be running this on a 400MHz PowerBook, but as you can see, this clamshell iBook SE runs it fine too. My first recommendation to enjoying this properly is to get a controller. It will recognise generic USB pads absolutely fine, but I dug around at the back of my cable drawer and found this PlayStation controller to USB converter. So, attach whatever PS1 or 2 controller you want on the end of this, and map the buttons accordingly, to avoid having to use the keyboard. The limitations here lie with the analog sticks, which will only register button presses if activated, thereby defeating the point. Boot the application up, allocate a memory card somewhere, turn off your hilarious screensaver, and get anything that might get in the way out of there, like ADOC or the control strip. All of these have the potential to stop the game's visuals from showing up. Then pop in your game disc and you're good to go. So let's start with a few titles that won't push the system so hard. Centipede seems basic enough. And hey, what do you know? It's playing seamlessly. The sound is fine. There aren't any graphical corruptions going on. Probably not what anyone would buy this software for, but a good start. Let's try and push it a bit harder then. With Abes Exoddus, a much worthier title. The first peculiarity here is the screen tearing that you can see in the cutscenes. It's not going to spoil your enjoyment of the gameplay, but obviously original hardware isn't going to do this. There's a bit of audio hissing too, in certain places. Again though, a minor issue. Keep in mind console emulation was patchy for pretty much everything back in the 90s, so mild oddities like this wouldn't have gotten a second thought. From what I can see here then, Abes Exoddus works absolutely fine. Let's try something more challenging, a system-defining platformer. Spyro III. This is looking promising. Visuals look clean. Pow! Where's the message telling me to press start? I'll try mashing buttons. Oh dear. I think we're stuck. Maybe the game plays alright, but the menu appears to be impassable. Spyro 3, then, is incompatible. I'm sure we'll be able to find a 3D platformer that works. How about Rayman 2? Cinematics seem okay. Hey, let's escape. This is pretty good. The controls are working well. Although one thing you can't do here is walk slowly, due to the aforementioned analog stick issue. Oh, don't cry kids, it's not that bad. Thankfully, the PS1 didn't begin its life with these, so there aren't many games that actually need them. Rayman seems to work perfectly fine, and gets a great big green tick. Next up then, something from the tail end of the system's life. Sheep, Dog and Wolf hit the shelves after Connectix VGS, so this should be interesting. First thing I've noticed is that the audio and video in the opening scene is out of sync. The game runs, so that's something, but the camera unfortunately gets stuck behind the walls. The first tight area here then is impossible to progress beyond. You just can't see what's going on. Sheep, Dog and Wolf, therefore, isn't really playable. Jumping genre then, here's Warzone 2100. A superb real-time strategy game on the PC that was made even better over time when it was open-sourced by its developer. The PlayStation version seems to be compatible, but falls flat for the same reason as most games like this on consoles. You really need a mouse. Selecting units is hampered by the controller, so issuing orders is incredibly clunky. The emulation is fine, so Warzone gets a tick. In comparison, a turn-based strategy game is a better fit for a console. The PlayStation port of Civilization 2 is reasonable. It doesn't look as good as the native Mac version, which has a better resolution, better graphics in general, a better input method, and more to do, although I was surprised to find that the PlayStation port had some music, which quickly became annoying. Nevertheless, Civ 2 gets a tick. Right, on to my favourite PS1 game. Team Buddies is an underappreciated hidden gem, blending strategic block building with excellent weaponized action. This was produced by Psygnosis's Camden studio in London, and emanates a delightful amount of Britishness in the dialogue, mission briefing, and general premise. It's a bit of a shame that my save with everything unlocked is on a physical memory card, so this footage is stuck with one map and the basic weapon set. Interestingly enough, an FAQ on the application's old website states that it can load memory card data dumped from a PowerDex, which I don't have. So there is a way to get your old save data on here. All in all, I'm thrilled to give Team Buddies a tick. Time for a drive. Oh no, not quite like that. I meant an actual driving game. Let's start then with the aptly named Driver. Bit of a problem to begin with, however. Apparently, the disc is damaged. Makes sense seeing as I had this as a kid and didn't learn how to take care of game CDs properly till much later. So it stutters and lags and takes ages to register an input. I didn't have much hope for this one, but did eventually progress, and got into a free drive to find it ran okay. I'd forgotten all about draw distance and pop-in until replaying these old titles. I definitely don't miss it. Moving on then, Ridge Racer Type 4 is next. This is the first console game I ever owned, and it works pretty well. I miss the analog input for it though. Steering is harder without it. The music to sound effects balance is a little off as well. It can be changed in the options, but I think that's a game issue rather than an emulator one. Let's do away with all this realism stuff and try a kart racer next. Speed Freaks came bundled with a multi-tap for 4-player split screen. Connectix VGS only supports 2 players, so this functionality is lost. The game seems to work okay half the time. The other half of the time, it hangs after the character select. I'm not sure what the variable is that causes it not to work occasionally, so it gets a yellow dash of meh as far as compatibility is concerned. Another semi-working title is Theme Park World, which can't recognise the virtual memory cards. The practice park is playable, but there are also errors in music playback. Certain notes are playing twice. Core functionality is completely broken here, as the main game isn't selectable without the ability to save. So the game gets a red X. Now, a key question I had to answer immediately after installing the app. Would it play Bomberman? I'm a big fan of Bomberman, and was disappointed when Hudson was absorbed by Konami. Annoyed that they did sod all with the IP for years, and then surprised and thrilled when Super Bomberman R was launched for Switch and was actually good. One of the best games in the series' back catalogue is Party Edition for the PlayStation. It's not a taxing game, graphics are pre-rendered pixels, so it gets a tick. An oddball game here is Bomberman Fantasy Race. Race on the back of Ruis and Tiras around colourful courses. You can boost off walls, collect usable items, and throw bombs. It runs great. Probably the earliest game I'm trying here, Shockwave by EA, was produced just before people realised that full motion video in games was rubbish. Connectix can play these just as well as any other cinematic, but this sort of thing doesn't make gameplay better. The basic graphics here isn't an emulation error, it's just bland as heck. The Mac got its own port that looks better, so if you really want to play Shockwave, and there isn't a good reason to do so, that would be the superior choice. We now progress to a third-person shooter. C12 was another late release on the console, which didn't really set the world on fire, but seems okay. It runs well, and seems to push the system to the top end of what it can do. Remember how you could open the disc tray of a PlayStation when it was on, and keep playing without a problem, so long as it didn't need to load anything? I tried the equivalent here, and got the app to eject the CD mid-game. The music stops, but that's it, until you exit the building. The final big red X goes to a game I wasn't expecting to have problems with. Tomb Raider 2 is the kind of game that I figured would be top of Connectix's list to fix compatibility with, due to its high profile. But try to start a game and it dips to black and doesn't come back. No major loss really, as the Mac got its own port. And finally, I did have a couple of demo discs which I figured might be interesting to try. One didn't boot at all, the other had the laggiest main menu you could imagine. Some of the demos didn't run, but others did. Vib Ribbon's audio was completely out of sync, which was surprising. But Terracon ran without hitches, as did this skateboarding game. Out of everything I tried then, just over two-thirds were playable. This isn't a scientific or absolute figure, but I feel anyone else would probably get similar results. For a PlayStation emulator from 1999, this is pretty good. It really was an impressive piece of software for its time. So, is it worth bothering with today? No, absolutely not. Its capabilities are dwarfed by modern emulators, and personally, I'd always choose original hardware over software anytime. Not least because all my good save data's on there. Connectix Virtual Game Station, then, is entertaining to experiment with, and its history is very interesting, but it serves no practical purpose today. That's it then for this episode of YesterYear's Mac Games. Share your thoughts in the comments, or on the Twitter. You can find me there at YYsMG. And if you like this video, you might be interested in some of my others. I cover old Mac games mostly from the 90s, a forgotten era of a much maligned platform for games. So subscribe to keep on top of new episodes, and thanks for watching. See you next time.